Could be messing around or struggling a little bit with the technology end of it, as I haven't spoken on one of these lavalier mics since we did the Epic Storytelling Festivals at VVC years ago. But I think I can get used to it. I do have a loud voice, so hopefully the combination of the microphone and me honking at you, it'll work out okay. One of the things that happened, it was kind of a synergetic moment or kind of a neat nexus of circumstances. As Adam was talking to me about doing the TEDx talks, I was also working with faculty at DVC and the administration to get the collection of fossil primitive casts that I've made over the years. I worked in Clark Howell's casting lab over at UC Berkeley for years. And I was allowed to make copies of all the different things. Everybody in the field, which is oftentimes very contentious, trusted Clark. So I was able to get access to things that very few places anywhere in the world have. And we've got a collection at DVC that will rival any of the Western colleges at all. You go up to Western Washington U or go up to Davis. Davis has some stuff, but this is a little piece of the collection. We've got 10 cases, and they're all stuffed in this one little classroom. But it just so happens that they're working on trying to get us all back. And when they do that, we're going to be able to move all the stuff into a big facility. And I thought, well, in honor of that and the fact that we just put together an anthro major for the first time at BBC, so we have an anthropology transfer major available, that I'd set up an institute where we could experiment with teaching people anthropology that matters. Matters not to us, but to them. I mean, we're all human beings, and so if we can understand a little more about ourselves, it made sense that we might be able to make better decisions about our lives, do better things for others around us, and that sort of thing. So I'm starting an institute. I've talked to the other biological anthropologists and other interested faculty, and we're starting an institute called the Institute for Practical Evolutionary Anthropology. And this talk seemed like a natural for that. It came together about the time that I ran into a copy of a book by Dan Lieberman called The Story of the Human Body. And if you've seen that, you know what I'm talking about. It is a great book. Dan Lieberman is one of the foremost paleoanthropologists in the world, probably the foremost or one of them anyway, evolutionary anthropologists. And he's put together a book that starts at the beginning of the human story, goes all the way up through industrialism and agricultural revolutions and all that sort of thing, and takes sort of an evolutionary perspective and figures out so what. You know, because I find a lot of times when I'm telling my students about stuff that happened millions of years ago, they look at me and they go, so what? Because they really, they don't understand, especially if you see all the precursors. And we've got across the table here, I've got casts of replicas of all of the precursors that are kind of going to be involved in my talk, starting with early apes that weren't even on the path necessarily to us, but that were adapted to eating fruit in tropical forests. This is a cast of a skull found in East Africa called Afropithecus appropriately. Pithecus means ape, and Afro just means it comes from Africa. This is another thing called Sahelanthropus, the Sahel man, or the man from Chad, and Sahel is a geographic region in Chad. Now this one's about maybe 16 to 18 million years old. This one's about 6. Both of them show aspects of what we anticipate was going on in our evolutionary history. If we go back to those time frames, we don't know if this is our ancestor or some side branch. But the fact is that these were fruit eaters, and when you look at the teeth of a fruit eater, look how the front teeth stick out. So this is a pattern that we saw in their biology or in the fossils. When we looked at the fossils, when we look at modern chimpanzees, we find the same pattern. Notice the front teeth, the incisors are pointing forward. There's a gap between them and these great big canines. And then they've got little tiny cheek teeth. These animals are adapted to eating fruit. Fruit is soft. Fruit has lots of fiber in it. It's really healthy. But it is not really abrasive to the teeth. So apes, like chimpanzees and gorillas, gorillas eat more leaves, but they still eat kind of soft stuff. So the first human-like things that show up in the fossil record, this would be the earliest known, or a cast of the earliest known skull of a pre-human, we call them a hominin today. And it shows some of the very characteristic patterns of transition between a forest-dwelling, fruit-eating ape and a bipedal or somewhat, sometimes upright walking, short face without the big canine sticking out, or without the incisor sticking out, and without a big canine. So it's small canines. This is probably tied in with a shift in the geometry of the jaws. Now, in the old days, people looked at jaws as if they were signs of evolutionary relationships. They say, well, it's got a big forward-facing jaw, or it's got a flatter face. That had some evolutionary, or you know, sort of taxonomic significance. They say, well, a short-faced man, like me, Leaky, named Kenny Anthony, was fighting. It was a flat-faced man. And the flat face was supposed to be a sign of something. This thing has a relatively flat face, and it also has a kind of a relatively flattened skull because it got distorted. But what we're seeing, when you get to the point of the first blip in our direction, you see, and the way I'm going to lay this out tonight, I'm going to talk about four different intervals, three couple million year long periods. The first one being the period of bipeds in the forest eating food, and they've recently done, and I attached to the handout that I passed out, a copy of the analyses of the carbon footprint, the stable carbon isotope footprint that's been obtained from the teeth of all these different kinds of animals. So Ardipithecus and Sahelanthropus, they have what's called a C3 carbon footprint. That means that they ate food derived from tropical forests. Tropical forests, primarily fruit perhaps, or animals that ate fruit. If they ate a whole bunch of monkeys that were eating fruit in the forest, they'd have the same chemical footprint because eating or digesting an animal's organs or you know, tissues doesn't change the carbon footprint. You know, the carbon just gets moved on through. And it's a ratio of carbon 12 and carbon 13 in any event. So the ratio starts to change about 3 point. I just got back from a conference in Calgary, and a good friend of mine, Johannes Haile Selassie, announced that from a place called Lorenzo Vile, where they have a foot of a human ancestor or a hominin with small canines and bipedally adapted, but it has a divergent big toe. And he shows that at that point in our history, these things, in almost 4 million years ago, they had made a shift. They had started to move out into more mosaic habitats, and they had started to consume more of the materials that were derived from open country, which have a footprint of carbon-4 as opposed to carbon-3. Now, the details or the technicalities of that aren't as important as what they tell us about the paleoecology of these forms. So, apparently, the early forms here, like Ardipithecus, this is a cast of the foot of Ardipithecus. Ardipithecus' foot looks a lot like the foot of a chimpanzee. However, it's more rigid in this midrange, and it has a larger astragalus. That tells us that it was bearing more weight on its feet, and that its foot was more stable, so that it could support its weight on four toes, but it still had the other toe, the fifth toe or the big toe, the hallux, sticking off to the side of the foot. And that meant that this thing was moving out of the forest into woodlands and more open country, but still heading for the next patch of trees where it could get its fruit. And when it got to that next patch of trees, up the tree it went with this opposable big toe. We know that that's what these feet are adapted to do. When we look at the feet of these forms in here, we've got fossil footprints, which I'll show you a couple slides of. And then we also have casts of footprints from this general time frame showing that all the toes, this is only a partial foot, but it shows that all the toes were facing forward. The big toe was up next to the other toes, and the big toe bone and the little toe bone were both big. And that means that they were supporting their weight across their foot, very similar to the pattern that you see in modern human feet. This is a modern human foot. You can see this toe, or this metatarsal, and this metatarsal are both large. So what does that tell us about what these forms were doing? They were moving out into open country. They were becoming more bipedally adapted, but because they have this different carbon fingerprint ratio, in other words, a footprint ratio, we say, well, we've got a mixed C3, C4 feeder, but they're not going out into the open country and finding more C4 food or C3 food, climbing up trees. They've given up on the trees. Now they're staying on the ground, and they're either eating underground storage organs like roots and tubers, or they're eating things that are on the plants there, or they're eating some aspects of the grass. Or, and from 3.4 million years ago, Zorayla, again, over at the Cal Academy of Sciences from a site called Tejica, where they found that little juvenile skeleton a few years ago. He's actually found antelope bones that have been cut with stone tools. So even though they weren't implements in the sense of being hand axe, already you've got evidence of meat eating, and you've got evidence of butchery, and you've got evidence of these hominids extracting things from other parts of the environment than have ever been done or has ever done by any other modern primates. Chimpanzees don't go out, they've got monkeys in trees. They're not gonna go out in the savannah and go look around for any kind of carcasses or any kind of animals that are out there. So that takes us up through a period of time where chewing becomes a really premium sort of act. And one of the things that's happened, and what Dan Lederman talks about a lot in his book, is because the subtitle is Evolution, Health, and Disease. He points out that if we cut back on our fiber intake, we're going to really have problems with our health, because our bodies are designed to have fiber in our diet. These animals probably chew 4 to 5 hours a day. Now, how many of you chew more than 10 minutes a day? That's unlikely, because all our food is processed by machines. We take on all the fiber, all the stuff, so you get some fluffy thing, and you eat it, and it tastes great. The only problem is, none of that stuff should be consumed by human beings, and that's one of the problems. We end up in an ecological or evolutionary mismatch. When you look at this guy, they initially called this guy the Nutcracker Man, because he had massive teeth and jaws. When you look at his brain size, it was pretty much the same as an ape's. All these things had ape-sized brains. Here's a cast of an ape-sized brain. Shows you about how big a chimpanzee's brain would be, and this happens to be a model of a brain of a human ancestor, and it has holes in the brain case from leopard teeth. So we know that that was another issue that you had to deal with if you're going to be out in a more open country where the predators like leopards are common. And somehow or other, for several million years, these human-like things, they made a shift, they became better bipeds, they became more adapted to eating a variety of foods. In other words, they diversified, and meat started to become important to them. About 2 million years ago, another big transformation happens. Now, in the old days, anthropology was always constructing what they called lineage phylogeny. So you'd have an evolutionary tree going from an ancestor to us. And everything that was discovered in between was fit onto a line. So they say, well, we've got Homo erectus, we've got Neanderthals, we've got modern humans. Well, turns out that that's not how evolution typically works. What happens is a new design shows up, and then it allows diversification, so you get several species that are all variations on a theme. And that's what these are. This is a male of the species that was nicknamed Lucy by Don Johansson when he named it back in the 70s. And this is a thing, this is called Paranthropus boisei. This is the culmination of the trend towards more open country grass feeding or grass animal eating, feeding. This thing, Paranthropus boisei, was an 80% C4 feeder. So that kind of is all the small brain things, big chewers, small thinkers, chewing, 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 chewing across the landscape. About 2 million years ago, brain size starts to increase. This is a skull of Turkana boy. Turkana boy was a Homo erectus skeleton that dated to about 1.6 million years ago. And when it was found, it revolutionized the perspective on what these hominids were doing. Here is the hip and leg, or here's the hip and leg setup for Turkana boy. He was about 8 years old when he died, and he was already 5'3". He had modern human body proportions. When you look at Lucy's leg bones, you find that she had very short legs. So these hominids that were walking across the landscape in the early days, they were walking with legs that were way shorter. Lucy was walking, and these guys were all walking with their heads about this far off the ground. Homo erectus, not the case. They were up in this range, and they were getting bigger. And at the same time, brain size doubles, stone tools become sophisticated, and meat becomes part of the diet. They become hunters and gatherers. They're not just finding things out there, they're killing. And they develop these long legs so they can chase the animals until they drop. So this is a persistence hunting that takes care of that second section. That's the third thing. And the trend is larger and larger and more muscular bodies. Here's a Homo heidelbergensis, a Neanderthal, and here's an ancestor of modern humans dating to about 150,000 years ago from East Africa. You can see that whereas the Neanderthal face is jutting way out, these guys' faces are back under the skull, and they're heading in our direction. We have very small jaws, very short faces, pronounced chins, high foreheads, and our jaw muscles aren't very impressive. These earlier forms, their brain cases fused early, their brain, they grew up fast, they lived fast, died young, and apparently our group was the only one that provided these, or had these evolutionary slowdowns so that our development happened slower and we had the propensity or possibility of living a long time. Now, what do we do with that information and then this information about the ecological mismatch? If you only live 25 years, you probably don't care too much about ecological mismatches. If we were all going to die by the time we were 30, we wouldn't be sitting here going, huh, what are we going to do about this dietary issue? But as I've approached more than twice that, I've seen some of the issues that I, sort of the traps that I set for myself come to fruition, and that my health has suffered some of the things that you could predict from the ecological mismatches or evolutionary mismatches that have happened. So, when we look at all of these different forms, we can see there's a trend from the forest fruit to the more sort of apex predator things that are out there, and then when modern humans show up, they have a sophisticated understanding of nature. They have symbolic consciousness. This is a Venus figurine from 30,000 years ago, an anatomically modern human in Europe, made this thing, and there's no doubt that this individual, not only this type of human, not only modern humans just like us, not only made this art piece, but they made beautiful, sophisticated implements. When you look at the implements of Neanderthals, just a piece of stone with a sharp edge on it. You know, there's no art at all. You know, people talk about Neanderthals burying their dead. I doubt it, because burial of the dead in a ceremony means that you're thinking about a hereafter or an afterlife. You're doing something artistic, symbolic, whatever. Same thing for food. Why should we worry about food, and what is the problem with our food right now? Tribal peoples had stories that they told. They had a mythic imagination, and they were told how to make their food according to the will of the gods. And that usually involved taking some drugs that were in the plants or getting some medicinal benefits out of the plants, but putting together concoctions that were aesthetically together, and they had a formula. And so it was kind of a magical mentality, but that's something that's way beyond any other creatures, including Neanderthals, I would bet. So, what do we do about that for ourselves? Well, the problem that we've got, at least as far as I can see, is that our mythology has been taken away from us, and it's in the hands of the advertisers. Now, instead of hearing about what we should have done because Grandpa told us to do it, we're being told, this is what you need to do to be go to McDonald's and buy a couple of Big Macs and a supersized fry, and then you're going to feel much better. And they've even got mythological figures, Ronald McDonald, and he's symbolic of all this, strange ecological mismatch or evolutionary mismatch. You eat enough of that McDonald's stuff, and you're going to find out what it's like to die in your younger years rather than living to the potential years that you have if you, follow some of the simple advice. And so that was the net result of the practical evolutionary anthropology consensus that we developed. Are there any questions?
Were all of these upright beings, or did they have long arms and
features, or were they? Yeah, I do have one. This is a cast from about 3 million years ago of a human ancestor that would have been called an Australopithecine or an Australopithecine. These guys were probably about 4 feet tall. Look how much longer this ulna is than my ulna, and I'm 6 feet two. And and my proportions of my arms and legs, very modern. That's like Homo erectus. These ancient things, they had really long arms and short legs, but we're not sure exactly what Ardipithecus did, but by the time you get to the Australopithecines, the footprints of Laetoli are right in line. The big toes are right up next to the other toes, and they're walking across the landscape. So they were walking on their hind legs.